Welcome to Mayo Clinic Sleep Medicine Podcasts, a series for physicians, advanced practice providers, nurses, and other health practitioners treating sleep disorders or interested in learning about state-of-the-art advances in sleep medicine and sleep health. I'm your host, Dr. Michael Silber.
And I'm your co-host, Dr. Maitri Juna. We are both consultants at the Center for Sleep Medicine at the Mayo Clinic in Rochester, Minnesota.
The topic this afternoon is transvenous phrenic nerve stimulation for central sleep apnea. The treatment of central sleep apnea is controversial, especially in patients with heart failure and low ejection fractions. There's been considerable interest in transvenous neurostimulation as an option for certain patients. To discuss this, my guest today is Dr. Timothy Morgenthaler, Professor of Medicine and a board-certified sleep specialist at the Mayo Clinic in Rochester, Minnesota. Tim, thank you for coming. Awesome. Could you first describe for us the technique used and the rationale behind it? Who places the stimulator and how much training is needed?
Sure. And thank you for having me, Michael. So, you know, the primary indication for phrenic nerve stimulation is the treatment of central sleep apnea, particularly in patients with heart failure who maybe have not tolerated or have contraindications to mask-based therapies. And it is okay for patients who have concurrent cardiac devices. It's been shown to be, you know, safe and effective in these. That the premise behind it is that stimulation of the phrenic nerve intermittently will create inspiratory efforts that will break the pattern of central apneas by supplying, you know, correctly timed breaths. And so that will break this pattern of arousals and intermittent hypoxemia, nocturnal sleep fragmentation symptoms, and so forth. And it's postulated that maybe this will also reduce the adverse consequences of having central sleep apnea on cardiac and neurologic outcomes and quality of life. Now, the insertion process, which is what you asked me about, is very similar to the placement of a pacemaker or an implanted cardiac defibrillator. The procedure includes placing a single stimulation lead. It goes into either the pericardiophrenic vein or the right brachiocephalic vein. And it's usually inserted on the right side of the chest, but it could be put on the left side of the chest. It's just by custom that it's typically implanted on the right. So typically, the procedure is performed by electrophysiologists or cardiologists who place pacemaker-type devices. And they receive special training by the company that manufactures the device to make sure that they understand the function and correct placement of the device.
So for those of us who may not, you know, neurologists like me and others who work in sleep medicine, who may not have much experience with even pacemaker placement technique, it's done, I presume, under local anesthetic or not?
Yes.
It's a day procedure, I presume. Right. And which vein is it inserted through?
Yeah, so it is a same day procedure for, you know, the vast majority of patients. They typically will go to their cardiac laboratory where, you know, which is where these are placed. These are outpatient procedural suites, could be at a hospital facility or an outpatient facility, depends. The skin is prepared and draped in a sterile fashion. As I said, typically they'll place it on the right, but there are devices that are placed on the left. And then usually the entry is through either the right, most often the right, or could be the left subclavian vein.
Mm-hmm. Good. Well, studies, including a 5-year follow-up study, show good control of central sleep apnea. Has this resulted in improvement in patients' symptoms and quality of life? I know you mentioned that there may be, I know it's controversial, adverse consequences to the cardiac health of the patient, but at a superficial level, which may be what's most important for these patients, especially in heart failure, improvement in symptoms and quality.
Yes. So, yes, I think there have now been several studies that demonstrate that this type of therapy, you know, transvenous phrenic nerve stimulation, does improve both sleep metrics, so things like arousal frequencies and the counting of these events that we, you know, typically use to diagnose sleep apnea. But I think very importantly, they have been shown to improve patient-reported outcomes. So for instance, a sort of a pooled cohort analysis of the original remedy trial showed that not only did it reduce things like the apnea-hypopnea index, but it improved patients' report of quality of life measures, including things like daytime sleepiness and general well-being. That study did include patients with heart failure and those without heart failure. And one very unique aspect of the fundamental study that got this FDA approved, which I think is a very interesting feature, is that they inquired of the patients enrolled in the study, you know, would you recommend this procedure to a friend or a family member? And the vast majority said that they would. And so, you know, I think there is a substantial subjective improvement associated with this therapy, which I find as a clinician interesting because, you know, I think as I was beginning to learn more about central sleep apnea as opposed to obstructive sleep apnea, I think very often, maybe earlier studies would say, these patients tend not to be terribly symptomatic. And, or if they are symptomatic, they tend to have more sort of insomnia symptoms rather than sleepiness or fatigue. And I think some of these more effective therapies, which I think this might be more effective than some of the mask-related therapies, or at least in the trials, they really are showing patients reporting that, no, my quality of life is better. I'm less fatigued. Maybe I didn't complain of sleepiness to begin with, but I'm less sleepy now. And I think that's quite a remarkable feature.
It is. That's very helpful to know. So what are the downsides? Are there complications? How frequently do they occur? What adverse effects should patients be aware of before they commit themselves to this form of therapy?
Well, I think both for the clinicians and the patients, I'm learning that this is also true for hypoglossal nerve stimulation therapy for OSA. You know, these are technological devices trying to aid with a respiratory component of a sleep disorder. And so I think we really need to think about the whole patient, not just is their airway open or is their phrenic nerve firing or not. And we need to really enter into this with the thought that this is not going to be a one and done or a simple, you know, flick of the switch and everything's fine. And we need, I think as clinicians and the patients who may be, you know, hearing from the clinicians about this, we still need to really focus on good sleep habits, good sleep schedules. These are very fundamental things. And I would say particularly so for this therapy, as I'll explain in a moment. But complication-wise, the procedure is generally safe. Potential complications would include things like lead dislocation or lead fracture over time, maybe stimulation-related side effects such as discomfort or hiccups. In very rare cases, there might be device-to-device interactions if someone has both a phrenic nerve stimulator and a pacemaker, but these are checked for at the time of insertion and they've not been big problems. The reports, I believe, show that more serious adverse events have been relatively rare, with more than 94% of patients being completely free from implant serious related effects in the first 6 months. So they're generally well tolerated. And of course, just like a pacemaker, you know, you're making an incision, there could be bleeding, there could be insertion-related side effects and infection, but these are quite rare these days with, you know, in good hands. But I think, again, patients need to be told that managing the therapy will require close collaboration with a sleep physician. This device needs to be programmed, and it's not something that the patient can turn on and off at will. So it's programmed to keep a certain sleep schedule or a window during which time the device can become active. And that becomes important right now if someone, let's say, is very well managed here in Rochester, Minnesota, and they decide to go to Norway for a family reunion, that is going to have an impact on when that device should be active. And so one must anticipate that and program ahead of time the time zone changes that might take place and then reprogram when they come back. So there's a lot of back and forth that needs to happen between the clinician who's going to manage this and the patient.
Oh, very, very important points, practical points. So the major trial showed, as I think you mentioned, efficacy, including, I think you did say so, patients with both heart failure and those with idiopathic central sleep apnea. So which patients should we consider for this form of therapy? Is this a second line, a salvage therapy? Should they have failed other therapies first, or should this be considered first line? What's your take on this?
That's a really great question, Mike. And I think it's a little bit of a changing target. And so I'm going to share my opinion about this, and because that's the only thing I have right now. I do strongly believe that one should always consider therapies that are low risk, low cost, have a proven record of working. So for the most part, I think that patients, maybe should be first at least approached about mask related therapies, before they're considered for phrenic nerve stimulation. But I have to say that I'm beginning to change my mind in certain patients. So for example, we know that patients with low ejection fractions and symptomatic central sleep apnea, we really don't have other reasonable choices to treat them. So what, once we've said, well, we're going to treat them, this is a very good alternative for those patients. And it's been quite effective. And it's also been effective in patients with idiopathic central sleep apnea. And oftentimes patients with idiopathic central sleep apnea are younger patients, and they're looking forward to many years of dealing with a device. This, once it works, this is actually not very cumbersome. And so it may be preferable to that. And I guess I would just have to say also in terms of an evolving role for this, at this point, there are more patients who have been studied with this therapy than who have published data with many of the other therapies that we kind of consider more, established. And so far, the results are very good. So I think it is evolving. Myself, I still, I'm fairly conservative, so I tend to think first of mask-based therapies. But, maybe it's a little bit akin to hypoglossal nerve stimulation in OSA. I think maybe people are kind of moving along the lines of thinking, well, that might be a good therapy for some people as their initial therapy.
Good. That looks like the future may be a little different from how we've considered this in the past, because it's always been challenging, central sleep apnea. Now, I do find there's been some misunderstanding about some of the indications for phrenic nerve stimulation. And some people think, well, this we could use in neuromuscular hypoventilation. And I always have to try explain that, no, if you're dealing with something like amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, you've got degeneration of those lower motor neurons in the phrenic nerve, and then in the sort of Wallerian degeneration of the axons, and you're not going to be able to help these patients. This is for central sleep apnea, not for neuromuscular cases. Would you agree with that?
Oh, yes, 100%. And in fact, it's important to know, once again, the FDA approval is only for central sleep apnea, not for any form of hypoventilation. I would also say that particularly early on, as we started to do this procedure, we found insurance companies had little understanding of what this was. And then they were thinking, well, it's experimental therapy for hypoventilation. And we would have to sort of re-educate them to say, no, this patient doesn't have hypoventilation. They have central sleep apnea. As you rightly point out, you need to have intact, highly functional phrenic nerves. So any disorder that is going to affect the phrenic nerve is not going to be well approached by this therapy. And finally, many people don't realize it's only stimulating one phrenic nerve, not both. And for central sleep apnea in a patient with an open airway, that seems to be sufficient to control central sleep apnea. So, there are alternative therapies that involve, bilateral phrenic nerve stimulation, but this is not that.
Thank you. Yeah. Well, what final messages would you like to leave with our listeners?
Well, thank you. So I think that this form of phrenic nerve stimulation, I believe at this point, is a well-established treatment for central sleep apnea. I think it is efficacious for many patients. I think for patients who have symptomatic, moderate to severe central sleep apnea, certainly if they've not tolerated mask-based therapies or if they have contraindications to mask-based therapies, I think physicians should really consider referring their patient to a center that has experience with this therapy. And I think it's going to grow in the frequency with which it's used, because I think it's a good therapy.
Thank you, Tim. That's been, I think, very helpful for our listeners. I appreciate you participating.
My pleasure. Thank you.
We hope you enjoyed this podcast. If so, please tune in again through wherever you receive your podcasts as we discuss further topics in sleep medicine and sleep health. Thank you.